I'm currently here in Abisko, standing on a frozen lake in early spring. And we are testing an AUV system, an autonomous underwater vehicle here under the ice. The goals of the project are to define and test a mission concept for an exploration of Jupiter's moon Europa. And it's already the third project in a series of projects. In the first one, we defined a mission concept. In the second one, we started to build a vehicle, and this is now the test of this said vehicle. The vehicle is called Deep Leng, and it's currently actually behind me, starting or preparing for a dive into the lake.
Yeah, perfect.
Yeah, my name is Marius Wirtz. I'm an engineer at the DFKI Robotics Innovation Center in Bremen, Germany. And right now we are here in Abisko, in the north of Sweden, above the Polar Circle. The total scientific time maybe is about a week, because we also need to build and unbuild all the infrastructure, which takes some time in these harsh environments. And we get great support from the local team here, the Abisko Scientific Research Station. Today it's comparable cold to the days before. We have minus 9 degrees. We have a lot of new snow, no problem with rain or melting water anymore, and perfect sun, so it's really nice to be out here right now.
And one of the main goals for us here is to make sure that the whole docking capability of the vehicle is working out, meaning that it's able to find the hole in the ice back and dock into the docking station.
So the mission that we're trying to do here is, first of all, testing under this harsh environmental conditions, first of all, if our system works, our sensors work in such low temperatures, and our algorithms that we programmed for the robot would behave like the way we would expect them to. Today we were visiting a couple of waypoints that we pre-programmed for the robot, just to get a feeling of how it would follow these points, how deep it could go. For example, we were going as far as 250 meters away from our ice hole that we had for the robot.
Under ice navigation is more complicated than open ocean navigation, because you usually only have one place where you can need to return in order for the mission to be successful. In open ocean, if something goes wrong, you can always say, okay, worst case, I do surface and then send out a GPS signal over Iridium or other satellite communication. This is usually not possible if you operate under ice. You have one vantage point where you enter the ice, and that's the same as you usually have to return back to the surface.
All right, so we're diving.
We do now the long mission. Now it's starting.
We're going for a 100 meter journey with four legs. 60, okay, thanks.
So basically now we're making like a lawnmower run all the way down to 100 meters and then rotating and coming back, and we're doing this four times back and forth.
How is our depth?
It's fine. Yeah. So now we're coming back. We did like the first run, rotated, and now coming back, and then we will do this over again once we are here.
Stable at 50.
Just waiting for the depth to align and we'll go to 40.
Now going to 40.
So going to 40 meters. We're at 20 meters now.
Now going to 10.
Going to 10 meters.
So now we lost control for a bit and we have to bring it back manually, but we were lucky that we just lost control when we are quite close to the docking station. But the behavior is a little bit unsteady, so we'll go out now and figure, like, try to debug what was the issue.
For a robot to navigate autonomously under ice, you need three main components. Like any other robotic system, you need a navigation component that would tell you where the robot is. You need a control component to command the robot to go to a certain position, and you need a planning component to tell the robot where to go or what to do if something goes wrong. Communication underwater or communication under ice is one of the most challenging parts that we are trying to test here, because the communication bandwidth is very low because we're relying only on acoustics, which is the only source of communication that could travel for a longer distance underwater. Wi-Fi doesn't work. As I mentioned earlier, GPS doesn't work, and any kind of electromagnetic signal will not work underwater. So how do we communicate with a robot underwater? We barely communicate with it. It's running most of the time by its own, and it's sending us every couple of seconds this very small message on where it is at a certain moment in time.
Now we are coming back to the station.
Docking. Docking complete.
Yeehaw.
How would it find the way back? This is the most challenging part. As I mentioned, it would rely on its navigation sensors, which is something we call dead reckoning. So it has internal sensors that would measure its velocity over ground, for example, its angular velocity, and will try to estimate with time its position and try to trace all the way back to the docking station that we would have in the end. One of the most important lessons that I've learned is never underestimate the conditions where you're gonna operate your vehicle in.
Yeah, another goal that we wanted to achieve is to show our capabilities in the international community, to show that we are working on the topic of under-ice navigation, to show that we are confident enough in our systems to really go into the field, and maybe and by this be considered for a future mission, real mission to the Europa Moon. I think the tests were very successful up until now. We could show all our major parts. Due to COVID, the preparations were a bit shorter than we would have wished for, so we could not show the electromechanical docking, which we would like to have liked to show. But apart from that, we could show everything we wished for. And now we're collecting some nice data sets and expanding on the stuff we already did. Very happy with this field test so far.